And he's talking about feeling ordinary or being ordinary, and how he himself is the only one that sees himself as ordinary. What do you think of it? Because when he says, "I feel ordinary," I'm a little confused, because in the first sentence he says, "I'm not an ordinary 10-year-old kid." So he says he's ordinary. Maybe he's just feeling ordinary, and he wants everyone else to look at him as just an ordinary kid walking down the street or at school or something.
I think he means that he feels ordinary, like, on the inside, but when, like, he knows he's not ordinary on the outside because of his face. I think that's what he means.
But is that a good thing that he's not ordinary, or a bad thing? I think it's a good thing, because, like, not everybody's gonna be like a perfect cookie cutter person, and that's not like a bad thing to be different.
How do you think, like, Augie defines ordinary? Because no two people are the same.
Well, I also had that comment, like, what does ordinary mean? I think to Augie it means like normal, and you look normal, and you seem like other people, I guess. And then also, like, adding on to what Raya said at the end, it says, "I know ordinary kids don't make other ordinary kids run away screaming in playgrounds." So I think he kind of wants to get rid of the feeling that he's stared at everywhere he goes, and that he doesn't feel like everyone else.
Yeah. I think being ordinary is important to him, because if you're ordinary, then you fit in with people, which can be good and bad. But if I were Augie, I personally would also want to change my face, because it's such a bother, and people will always, like, for your whole life, make fun of you for it. So I don't think being ordinary means, like, being perfect and being exactly like other people, but being kind of similar to other people and having friends, and, yeah.
I think he means that he's not ordinary the way he stands out, like, what his face looks like makes him stand out a lot. And I think he doesn't always want to stand out. Sometimes he wants to be just fit in with everyone else and not have to deal with all the staring and stuff. So, yeah.
Well, if you were Augie, do you think you'd also want to be ordinary and change your face, or do you think you'd be, like, proud of who you are?
I think that it would really depend on like, where I was, like, how old I was, because it would definitely change over the years. Because he says, like, as a kid, he had, like, really good friends who saw him for who he was on the inside. So, like, at that moment, it seems like if it was him, I wouldn't want to change my face. But as, like, middle school and high school, definitely those would be the times when I would really feel like I hate my face, I want to change it.
For me, I would probably feel like sometimes I would like all the attention, but other times I would just want to fit in with everybody else and be like everybody else, like how I feel.
I feel like it's also on your surroundings. For example, if you're even in preschool or something, but you have really mean kids who bully you all the time and who tell you, "Oh, your face is so ugly," and all that, I'd want to change it, right? But then I really think it's your surroundings, because if you're in middle school and everyone accepts you and they love you for who you are on the inside and not what you look like, I feel like I'd be proud of what I look like and I wouldn't want to change anything. So I think it's based on your surroundings.
Yeah, I agree with Phoebe, like, to build on what you said. Like, I think I want to, like, change maybe, but I think he just wants to, like, feel accepted and, like, where he's at, because, like he wouldn't want to be not accepted and thrown into a corner, rather to fit in and be friends with most people.
I wouldn't care if my face didn't look ordinary. I would just want everyone to act like it was not ordinary, not to point it out or laugh or stare. I wouldn't, like, if my face was like obvious, and I wouldn't, it would be fine if everyone appreciated me.
Well, I wouldn't want people to pretend that they didn't notice and to act like, oh, like, you're normal or whatever, but I would just want people to accept me, but I wouldn't want people to notice and then just be like acting like they didn't care and stuff like that, because, yeah.
that Augie feels like the only way he'll get accepted is if he changes his face, the same way some people think, oh, the only way I can be accepted is if I like do different things and change myself. But honestly, the only way you'll get accepted is if people around you become kind and accept you. Like, this whole story is about kindness and about how you can be whoever you want to be and feel comfortable if everyone else around you is kind. And yeah, I think by the end of the book, he grows to feel more comfortable with his face because people become kinder to him.
When I was reading, it's the second paragraph on page one. First page. I read the last sentence. He says, "Here's what I think. The only reason I'm not ordinary is that no one else sees me that way." And I think that's a really good point because I think it's not if he thinks he's ordinary, because he does. He's saying he does, but a lot of times what other people say kind of defines you. Like, if someone says you're not ordinary, then you'll start to believe that you're actually not ordinary, especially if that person has a lot of social currency or something. So I think other people have made him think he's not ordinary. And I also think that everybody's, and then in the fourth paragraph he says, "And mom and dad don't see me as ordinary either. They see me as extraordinary." And I think that everyone is extraordinary, so you can kind of say that. It's only if people make you feel like you're not ordinary that you become like you're not ordinary.
You guys already announced this, but he's kind of letting other people, their reactions kind of let them define him. But he did like define himself, said that he thinks he's ordinary, but like I think after a while he's kind of letting them bring his opinion down on himself and let their opinion take over. I think he's spending too much time studying people's reactions on himself, because like he should just focus on like just living his life instead of focusing on how to be ordinary.
I want to add back to what Adrian said about how in the end of the book he felt accepted, and so his precept actually was, "Everyone in the world should get a standing ovation at least once in their life, because we all overcome the world." And I think that it's his way of saying, so when he was up on the stage and he was smiling, everyone was just really happy for him and clapping, and you could tell that they weren't faking it, like Catherine said, but they were genuinely happy for him and proud. I feel like that's what he means by this precept. That he thinks everyone deserves to be accepted, to feel happy on the inside, or feel ordinary, or feel whatever they want to feel, for example. And yeah, if you guys, what else do you think this precept means?
I'm gonna agree with you. Like, I think it means everybody deserves like some kind of like respect from everybody, because if everybody spends their whole life putting one person down, there's no good coming from that. But if you go around and you're respecting each other and you're being nice to each other, then you get more from that.
I agree with Sai. I think it means that everybody fights their own battle and stuff inside them, and you don't see the whole struggle, and everybody deserves to be applauded for that. Also, I have a question for anyone, but specifically for people who haven't really talked that much. What are your guys' favorite precepts?
Well, I like Mr. Brown's first precept. When given the choice between being right or being kind, choose kind. Because I think that when you're trying to be right, you kind of forget about what's going on and how it could be affecting someone else, and you're just like, oh, I want to win and I want to be right, but you can like think about how this could affect other people and maybe like give up like being right and try to like understand other people more.
I actually disagree with you, because I actually don't really understand the quote, because I mean, I understand that kindness is really important and that everyone should be kind, but being right and being kind are two like completely different things. So for example, what if being right could save someone's life, but you're not being too kind? Like, being right, it just doesn't really make sense to me. And like, most times being kind is being right. And like, being right doesn't really have a definition, so the quote doesn't really make sense to me.
I think it means as if you're in an argument of your opinion and you think, I'm right, you're wrong. But like, instead of always trying to be right, and you could be kind, maybe like try to find a solution to fix the problem of trying to be right. Because being right, like if you're saving someone's life and being right saves their life. Being kind is saving someone's life. Like, just leaving them to die is being kind.
My favorite precept is going for October. Your deeds are your monuments, because basically saying that the things that you do are important and that they matter. And so it kind of relates to the first one. Like, if you are known for just always winning and being right about everything, is that better than like being kind and being nice and helping people?
Yeah, but I can still be right while being kind. Like, if Summer and I are in an argument and she's saying that dogs can fly, I'll be like, no, dogs can't fly, which is correct. Would I just be like, okay, actually, yeah, dogs can fly, just because I'm being nice to her? Or should I be like standing for what I believe in? I mean, like, well, so what I'm saying right now, I believe it is right. You probably don't think it's right. But I'm still saying in a kind way. I mean, hopefully a kind way. I mean, I'm not being like, oh my God, you guys are all wrong, because you guys are all dumb, and so I'm always right. No, you can still be kind and right. You don't have to always choose kind.
But one of the ways it could be is if I was in an argument for you, like, say, and you just kept putting my arguments down, saying, nope, you're wrong, nope, you're wrong, we wouldn't be able to get anywhere. But being kind would be like saying, okay, I value your arguments, and compromising. And if you're just putting down, like, the other person's arguments, that's, like, and thinking that you're right, you won't be able to hear.
How would you compromise? Being like, oh, dogs can sometimes fly.
What Summer's trying to say is that you could be saying, instead of saying, oh, I'm right, dogs can fly, dogs cannot fly. And you're saying, like, oh, I'm right or whatever. Maybe you should just say, okay, well, I still don't believe this, but maybe you can believe that dogs can fly even though I don't believe it. Even though you know that you're right, you don't always have to make the other person understand that they're wrong and, like, put them down.
Okay, let's move on to this.
I have something related to this.
Okay,
so basically,
thank you.
In this precept, it's also, so in the movie when Summer was there and she kind of smiled because she knew that to her this meant, if I'm right, that being right was like being like everyone else and not talking to Avi because they're going to get plagued, or not going up to him because his face, or not eating lunch with him because what he looked like. I think that she was kind of smiling because she knew that is true, and she had to be kind. And so she chose to go up to him and meet him, and then they became friends. So
yeah.
That's what I think this means.
Well, also, like, you kind of showed me something, because being right, like, in the school stereotype, being, like, right would be, okay, the right thing to do is to stay away from Augie, don't touch him, don't eat lunch with him, don't eat with him. But like, she chose kind over what all the kids thought was right. So yeah.
My favorite precept, I mean, it's probably because it's funny, but I like the Your Deeds Are Your Monuments one, but I also like this one. It's on the fourth page, and it's the third precept. And it says, if you really want something in this life, you have to work for it. Now, quiet, they're about to announce the lottery numbers. Homer Simpson. I just think that one's funny. But, yeah.
My favorite precept? Well, like, I have many. Like, the one Catherine announced. Yeah, that one's pretty good. But, like, September, yeah, that one's pretty good. But then another one that I like is April's. Because, like, it also kind of defines August, because he said, it says, what is beautiful is good, and who is good will soon be beautiful. So, like, it could represent August, because, like, he's, like, a good person. Like, he's not mean in the book or the movie. He's nice, so... It could basically mean, like, he's beautiful, but, like, some other people don't think he's beautiful. So that's why it says he will soon be beautiful. So, like, in the end, people start, like, fitting him in, kind of making him feel beautiful. I don't know. But that was my third favorite precept, I think.
I want to go back to what Andre said about the Homer Simpson one. I think this one actually has, like, some kind of truth to it, because in the first part it says, if you really want something in this life, you have to work for it, and I think that's really true, because you can't just go through life without doing anything and without having any work and just sitting.
That's exactly what he does.
I think that's the point.
But, yeah.
So. It's time to pack up and leave. Everybody, and I'll say my stuff. So Summer had one interruption, one question, and that's it. And Aiden had two interruptions, two text references, and one connection previous to comment or work, and one name reference. Lily had nothing. Catherine had two interruptions, one question, two text references, one connection to previous comment or work, one name reference. And Andre had one question, three text references, two connections to previous comment or work, and one name reference. And Phoebe had zero interruptions, two questions, three text references, two connection to previous comment or work, one and one name reference. And Sai had two text references, three connection to previous comment or work, and one name reference. And Raya had one question, one text reference, and one connection to previous comment or work. Zoe had one text reference. Adrian had two interruptions, two questions, two text references, and one connection to previous comment or work.